Near the end of the 4th century, a young man named Macarius the Great lived outside of his village and was serving Christ amidst the local people. A young woman from the village ended up accusing Macarius of seducing her and getting her pregnant. She didn't want the actual father of the baby to be known, so she accused Macarius. Macarius was then viewed as a disgraced priest in the city. Macarius doesn't defend himself. Macarius accepts the accusation and expects God to be his defense. He says, "Well, Macarius, now you have a wife." And he takes what he was doing, basket weaving and mat weaving, and selling those things, he expects that he's going to support this woman who's now pregnant. 9 months goes by and she comes full term and she enters into labor, and 1 day passes and 2 day passes and 3 day passes and she still hasn't given birth. And she realizes that unless she exonerates Macarius, she's never going to birth the baby. So she screams out, "Macarius is not the father, this man's the father," and Macarius is exonerated. And he becomes a bit of a local celebrity. Everybody wants a piece of Macarius. They want his advice, his counsel, his wisdom, his prayer, and all Macarius wants is to be alone before God in silence and solitude, divulging his heart and being made and formed in the image and likeness of Christ. But he can't get that now because he's inundated by people that are coming to him. So Macarius removes himself from the village to seek Anthony the Great in the desert of Egypt in order to study under one of the most notable figures of that day. And Anthony the Great taught Macarius the Great the spiritual life in the desert of Egypt. There's a few things that Macarius taught about the spiritual life that are incredibly helpful and impactful for us to grow, especially as it pertains to spiritual giftedness. When we grow in the spiritual life, there's a corresponding increase in giftedness and ability to minister on behalf of God. So understanding some of the principles of growth can be incredibly helpful to grow in being useful and used by God. Macarius taught that there was a rhythm to the spiritual life, that sometimes the fire of God within burned hot and sometimes it would wax cold. And he taught to be consistent in the midst of that, to expect that rhythm and embrace the fire when it came, but work through the cold seasons when they were there. Macarius taught that when the Holy Spirit worked in the inner life of the individual, there would be various effects such as filling the inner man with joy and pleasure, a deep communion and abiding sense of peace, a deep communion like being in the chamber with the bridegroom, that we'd be caught up in heavenly encounters, that we'd be moved with grief and sadness over all mankind interceding on behalf of humanity, that we'd be inflamed with love and joy for others. The Holy Spirit would work a deep humility within the heart when he came upon the individual. That we'd be led into spiritual battle like a strong warrior. He taught that the Holy Spirit would produce silence, calmness, peace, and spiritual pleasure within the heart of the individual. He taught that there'd be an impartation of spiritual knowledge that's beyond words. When Macarius dealt with the people that he was discipling, he was soft and helped them to grow. One time he came to one of his disciples who was struggling with lust. Macarius asked him a question and said, "Hey, how are you doing, my brother?" And the brother said, "I'm doing fine." You know, just like any normal Christian would say, "I'm doing fine." And Macarius, recognizing what was going on with the man, said, "Oh, that's great that you're doing fine. I've been struggling with lustful thoughts." And the man, in the moment, was able to be open with Macarius, and he divulged and confessed, "I've been struggling, Macarius. Would you please pray for me? What do I need to do?" And Macarius said to this man, "Fast a little bit, pray a little bit more, and I'll pray for you, and I'm sure that the Lord will give you freedom from this issue." And sure enough, the man did that, and he found freedom. The thing is, Macarius wasn't struggling with lustful thoughts. He decided to take a humble posture in order to help the man that he was discipling grow. Macarius taught that remembrance of wrongs would stand in direct opposition to the presence of God in the heart of the believer. So he said, if we keep remembering the wrongs that have been done to us, we destroy the remembrance of God. The presence of God was what the spiritual man was seeking. It was absolutely imperative to release forgiveness to the people that had hurt you in order to enter into the presence of God. Who of us have not sit down to pray in a moment of silence and not been drawn away in our thoughts to the people that have hurt us and have spoken against us when we intended to pray and intended to enter the presence of God? Forgiveness truly is absolutely necessary to embrace the presence of God deep in the inner man. Macarius lived his life by three guiding principles: considering himself dead to the world, considering himself dead to others, and turning his heart ever towards God. In considering himself dead to the world, he was able to die to the opinion of others. In considering himself dead to the opinion of others, he was able to constantly turn his heart towards God. This was the goal of the life of Macarius: to live in union with Christ.